Hi everyone, welcome. This is How to Design a Stable High Frequency Amplifier, Part 7. So far in this series, we've gone through various measures of stability. In the last video, I showed you how to use a new probe, called the WS probe, to quickly arrive at some of those measures. The objective today is to show a few examples of, well, how to design a stable high frequency amplifier. I'll show two amplifier examples here. In the first example, I want to illustrate what it entails to use the probes to compute a nonlinear normalized determinant function with the real device model. And in the second example, I'm going to show how to use a design technique where you can kind of be clever about EM visualization to track down some feedback loops. I hope you've downloaded the companion workspace by now, but if you haven't, you can get it for free at the link below. All right, let's go to the examples. The first example is included in your workspace. This is a Class C amplifier at 935 MHz. Now, Class C power amplifiers are biased such that the conduction angle is very low, and the RF signal is actually needed to turn on the device. So if I sweep input power, you can see that the device isn't even on until we put in about minus 10 dBm, then the gain comes up. So doing stability analysis like NDF at low power just won't work. This needs to be a large signal simulation. One of the biggest impediments to doing NDF is that you need to be able to turn off the internal gain element, and ideally you can even access the intrinsic terminals. Well, here I've got a real device model. This is a stats model, and there's just no way I can get inside of this model. This is as far down as I can go. But it is possible to remove the gain, and the way that I do it is by zeroing out the beta and lambda parameters in the model card. And then I can use an if statement to switch this based on an input variable. Now I want to point out one more practical consideration. For proper NDF computation, you need to preserve the DC conditions even when the device is off. So to do that, I added another device connected with DC feeds, and I switched this one on when the other one's off and vice versa. So even when this device is off, there's still DC. I like to think this is kind of a slick way to build an NDF capable model. Now we'll go back up and sweep the gain toggle switch, and when I look at the results, you can see that the model parameters are switched off, the gain is zero. Okay, let's use WS probes to compute NDF. I have two devices, but this connection is interesting here. One of these devices is directly grounded, and the other's not because I want to make a point. The goal is to get WS probes as close to the device as possible. That's just generally speaking. For the top device, that means we can put WS probes in the gate and drain, but the source is grounded. And for the bottom device, it actually means gate, drain, and source because the source isn't grounded. So I'll have five WS probes here. Okay, now I'll remove the power sweep, making PN13, and instead we'll sweep the small signal frequency over a wide range and check the perform stability analysis box in the harmonic balance tab. I run the simulation, and then to compute NDF, I use this function. It's included with your workspace. It's called WSPY matrix. And I always uncheck calculate expression automatically for this one. Since this equation has inputs that are text-based, I need to make sure to hit the update key on the equation when things change. And I'll put in all of the probe names as strings here, and then I need to hit the C key to compute this when I'm done. Okay, so this gives me the Y matrix. Next, I do external NDF equals the determinant indexed on over the determinant indexed off. And I'll add one more function, check NDF. This equals encirclements of the external NDF function. And now I'll plot the check NDF function, making the x-axis a log scale. And this shows that the NDF does in fact encircle one, so the circuit is unstable. Now, I'm providing the circuit in the workspace, and I will leave it to you to figure out how to make the circuit stable. The only thing I want to point out here is that this instability is power dependent, meaning that if I change PN, the result can change. And to illustrate that, I'll make PN really high, like 27. Now, you might think that this would make this amplifier very unstable, but actually when I rerun this simulation and I'll recompute NDF, you can see that now it actually makes it stable. So the probes allow you to do a large signal NDF on your design and see how stability changes with nonlinear conditions. Okay, moving on. The next example I'm going to show is a gallium nitride power amplifier at 1 GHz built using a Qorvo transistor and a real device model from Modelithics, so I wanted to say thanks to both companies. What I'm going to illustrate in here is how problems can arise if you're not careful about modeling unintended feedback loops. So here I've got a transmission line-based schematic. This is usually a pretty good way to start your design. And the fundamental amplifier performance looks pretty good, so now it's time perhaps to analyze stability. In this circuit design, stability was somewhat considered. You can see there are resistors on the gate and there's bypassing on the DC supply, so both of these things are good practice for stabilizing high-frequency circuits. And I've added Winslow probes to both the gate and drain of this device, and now we'll run a large signal simulation to get the results just like before. Now, in contrast with the last example, this transistor does not have the ability to toggle the intrinsic source on and off. I'd say that's really a common scenario in real life. So we can't reliably get to a large signal NDF computation. Now, the good news is we have an entire toolbox of techniques encapsulated in the WS probe, so we can look at some of the other metrics instead of NDF. In the data display, I plotted the driving point admittance, and what I do first is look at the real part, and I check it for negative values. Now, one trick is to take the minimum of the entire sweep and look at the sign. In this case, it's positive, so that's good news. It indicates the amp is stable. And as one last check, I'll look at the true return ratio version of loop gain in dB. That's directly from the probe output, and this value is very low. It's basically zero. Now, if you did this design, you might think, great, the amplifier is stable. You know, I'm going to go on vacation. But it's not that easy, unfortunately. If you look closely at the schematic here, you might notice something, which is there's no feedback loops modeled here. Everything is tied to this ideal ground, and there's just no trace coupling anywhere in the circuit. And especially at high frequencies, you really need to ask yourself, how realistic is this? Anytime you see a loop gain this low, it's suspicious. Okay, let's look at the physical layout. So I've got this loaded in our PathWave EM tool called RF Pro. And if you have an experienced eye, you might start to see some potential feedback loops appear in this layout. So I ran an electromagnetic simulation of the circuit from 0 to 10 gigahertz. And one thing I really like about RF Pro is that you can just click a button and get a circuit model that you can then use in your simulation. So I went back to the circuit and I replaced all of those lumped elements with the EM structure and then I reanalyzed. And now when I do the analysis, some red flags start to appear. Driving point admittance has a negative minimum value, so I want to run a more thorough stability check of Kurokawa's condition. And I've got a function here to do that, WSP driving point, that's in your workspace. And this function analyzes any number of driving impedances and returns the unstable frequencies. It's very convenient. So I pass both probe outputs into this function, and multiple frequencies got flagged as being unstable, both below and above the primary transmit band. These warrant some further investigation. Next, I look at the bilateral loop gain, aka the true return ratio, and I see some high gain sections that roughly correspond to the unstable driving point admittance frequencies. As a designer, of course, your goal is to get to the bottom of these loop gain problems. So is this all that the probe can tell us? Well, no. The next step is to learn about the directionality of the loop. In other words, does the signal leak from the output to the input, or does it leak from the input to the output? And the Osttest loop gain is really useful for being able to do that. So to emulate Osttest, I use an equation to process the probe output, WSP loop gain. I pass in an option uni, and that means that the signal goes out the output side of the probe and it comes back through to the input side. If you look at the drain probe loop gain unidirectionally, you can see that just about all of the low frequency loop gain seems to travel from the output side to the input side. Now I can easily reverse the direction too. It's the same equation with the reverse option passed in, and that shows very little low frequency gain travels in the reverse direction. But interestingly, at higher frequencies, the loop gain is more bidirectional. So how do you get to the bottom of something like this? Well, there's lots of ways to do that, but let me show you one technique that I think is pretty neat. What I'm going to do is use the circuit simulation to electromagnetically excite the physical layout. So I'll run an AC simulation and pass in a large signal, but now I sweep frequency, and I do that on the same circuit and EM model that I just simulated with harmonic balance. And when I have those results, I'll go back to RF Pro, and in the results tab, I click view current density. Now I can excite this layout in a number of ways, but I'll select circuit excitation, and then I'll pick the data set from the AC simulation that I just ran. And this will use the circuit results to drive the physical EM structures. Let's look at 100 megahertz, the lower frequency oscillation. If I adjust the scale, you can now see a spot light up. This is the bypassing circuit ground, which is coupling the signal across. And from the Osttest, I know the direction of the coupling is going from the output to the input. So this is something that I need to fix in the design. Let's go to 3.4 gigahertz. This is roughly the high frequency oscillation point. And notice now how the ground plane lights up around the transistor. This is showing coupling between the matching capacitor grounds, output to input, and actually input to output too. So I probably need to add more vias here to improve the isolation at this area of the circuit. Okay, well, I modified the design later to separate the bias lines, and I also added some resistance to the larger bypass caps to DQ those feedback loops at the lower frequencies. And I also added more ground vias below the matching network to improve the isolation at high frequencies. And when I rerun the circuit simulation, you can now see that the design is stable. And you can also see that in the EM excitation too. Clearly the coupling has been improved pretty significantly. So I hope this example illustrates just how efficient you can be in designing for stability and high frequency circuits if you have the right tools at your disposal. Well, that about wraps things up for me. In this video series, I hope you learned a lot about stability, but truthfully, what I've shown here is just the start. The fun part, in my opinion, is to take these approaches that I showed and try them out in your own circuits. I've always found that the more stable the circuits are, the happier the design engineers are, and that's ultimately my goal. Please download the workspace, and if you like the video, subscribe to our channel for updates. Thanks for watching.